Hi, everyone, and welcome. I'm Chris Van Wingerden, Senior Vice President, One Success here at dominKnow.
And I'm Brent Schlenker, VP of Learning Experience at dominKnow as well.
Yeah. Hey, welcome, folks, to this session of Innovation, dominKnow's live podcast focused on innovating your e-learning strategy, tools, teams, and processes in ways that drive business outcomes for your organization. It's so great to see so many folks with us here for this live session today. We're really excited to have you with us.
Indeed.
Our goal with innovation is to help you connect the many silos of organizational improvement. We all know that organizational improvement isn't a one-time event. It's a constant and ongoing process. And we hope that innovation helps bring the world of learning, development, and training together with the world of performance support and knowledge management. We have a great link for you to use to sign up for the series newsletter, keep in touch with us, learn about upcoming episodes, and more. So if you haven't done that already, feel free to do that. Today, Brent is bringing us his time with Michelle Lentz, who's led learning teams at Oracle and UPS. Brent, tell us a bit about Michelle.
Yes, Michelle is a fabulous friend and colleague, has been for a long time, which you'll hear about in the interview. She's had some amazing experiences, and I'm just super excited she was willing to talk to us and share her insights, being in HR and learning and development and, helping folks get better at what they do, which is what we're all about.
Yeah, for sure. That's so cool. I'm really looking forward to hearing your conversation with Michelle. Folks, just ahead of that, though, during the conversation portion of today's program, feel free to drop questions or comments into the questions panel, and we'll do our best to catch up on your comments and ideas as we go along here. Brent, I think it's time to meet Michelle and hear the first part of your conversation.
Let's do it without further ado. Hi, Michelle. How are you?
I'm good, Brent. How are you?
Doing great. Thanks for joining me today.
No problem.
We've chatted before, and you and I have been friends in the industry for a long time, but tell those folks that are listening a little bit about who you are.
I've been in learning and development in HR, talent management, for 20-ish years. I should probably lie about that number.
Has it been that long? Have we known each other that long? Wow.
Probably. Yeah. Or at least 15 of those years, probably.
You're part of them, yeah.
I have done everything from work at Trivantis, where I helped launch Lectora way back when.
Ooh, and wow, there's a blast from the past,
six,
huh?
Yeah, employee number six there. And now through working at Oracle, working within talent management, organizational effectiveness there. My last role was at UPS. Currently, I'm coaching and a full-time dog mom while I'm looking for a new role.
Fantastic, fantastic. And you just completed that road trip across the country.
Right, from Seattle, from Arkansas to Seattle, which is
good times.
and an EV with a weenie dog. So
okay, yeah. You know, I suppose you and I should catch up at another time. We probably have some things we need to talk about today. So talent development, HR, knowledge management, learning and development, all that good stuff that we've been doing over the last 15 odd years. Let's just start with an easy one. Where do you see this world of ours? Maybe we'll focus on L&D first from a talent perspective. You know, where are we at currently? Is it or how would you define it? How have you seen it in your space?
I think when I left GPS, we were flirting a little with this idea of AI. Mm-hmm. And in some spaces throughout UPS, not necessarily where I was in learning and development, but in other places, they were starting to use it. And you see it in more customer-facing areas. So when you go on the UPS website and you want to track your package, you can talk to the chatbot.
Yeah.
And so I think that's where we're going. You and I were talking about this offline, that performance support is really these little things. They're not just like courses anymore. We're pulling all this knowledge, and I think AI is where it's going to help us. It's not just guided learning and things like that anymore. It's AI pulling that knowledge forward, and we just have to train the AI. I think that's our new job, is training the computer.
Yeah, and getting it to do what it does best, right? It's more of a, it kind of makes us better at what we do. I know a lot of people are kind of afraid that it's going to replace us, but I think the mantra that people have kind of come up with these days is it's just going to make us better at what we do. We're going to use it to be better and more effective at the work that we do.
Well, AI is just repeating the information we give it, right? I mean, it's not how. It's not alive yet.
Yeah, being the operative term, right?
But I'm always nice to all computers, including the Roomba, Alexa, all of it, just in case. But I'm always polite. I don't want to be the one they come after. But, you know, I think right now all that information comes from us. So we still have roles to play. And I've been in a couple of AI classes since I left UPS, and just learn. I'm so fascinated by it and what role we can play in HR. And I've been learning a lot about domain-specific large language models. And so you can take your AI and just make it very specific to your area. And so it's not just ChatGPT who knows everything up to 2021. You can have your own bubble of AI.
That's that idea of your own bubble of AI, I think, is something that echoes a lot of stuff that I've been seeing in my own media streams. I follow a lot of technical people, lots of thoughts being shared in the space about AI, not just in our space, but in any space in general. Lots of questions around and concerns in some cases around, you know, the content that something's being trained on. If it's out there, who actually owns the content, and therefore what's the relationship or what's owed back to the people who originally created something, you know, on websites, etc., that kind of information. And then also just the having assurance in the quality of the content. We've all seen the sharing of some of the most absurd sort of AI responses, and those things obviously gather steam, but and we only see those absurd versions, but even sometimes there's smaller concerns. So if you're able to isolate the training of the AI on just your own company's content that already, you know, exists, and you have faith in the quality of that, then you can take that forward, I would say, and have faith or greater faith in the AI remixing of that combining it, et cetera. And also, you know, reducing that sense that you're getting content from somewhere and you're not sure, you know, where it is. It's an important thing to think about for us.
Yeah, for sure. And I think one of the things that strikes me the most about those AI conversations is just how fast it all popped up and became a thing, right? It's just been so, just a year, not even, I mean, maybe just a little over a year. I mean, obviously the tech's been going on for a really, really long time, but for it to go mainstream and for everybody to get to play with it, and for us as an industry to get to try things out. There's so many people out there doing some very interesting things to test it out, and it just keeps changing and updating itself so fast. So I'm curious to see what L&D professionals and HR professionals do at the end of the day, and support teams as far as taking care of it. But I have a sneaking suspicion that it's not going to be taking our jobs anytime soon, that it might enhance us a little bit, but I don't, or a lot of bit, but I don't, yeah. I think we're still going to be a necessary human intervention point, if for no other reason than for what you mentioned, the those legal implications can be pretty significant as well.
Yeah, so. For sure. So much of what we do tells people to do things or gives them advice on things or et cetera. There can be risks with that too for an organization too. So,
yeah, absolutely. So, In this next part of the conversation, I decided to slow us down a little bit and start us over. So let's jump to that and center the conversation a little bit, and then we'll come right back.
You know, I don't know. I've seen really good ones, and I've used some that have just frustrated me so much. So,
let me slow down the AI here a little bit for us, and let's just dial it back a little bit, and maybe give us a little bit more detail on what did your role look like, whether UPS or one of your other roles or whatever in that space, and then if you were, let's just hypothetically say you're still in that role, how would you see, you know, AI or, you know, the newer things that are going to happen, maybe have, you know, how's that going to change that role? What did that look like?
You know, right now, when I started UPS, a lot of it was come in to modernize the call center training, which at the time really just meant moving to e-learning.
Yeah. Isn't it interesting that there's still so many companies that are at that spot? You know, when you and I met, we were in the beginning, early stages of that shifting to e-learning, right? And now we're in 2023 and some people are still making the transition.
Right. We were creating Lectora back in 1998, I think. I mean, so it's been a long time for that transition. But, and honestly, for what we were doing with everything in the call center training, I don't know if it was necessarily the right move because of how it was being used. But that was my role. But in other parts, we were rolling out things like Salesforce. Well, in that, I was really pushing so hard for guided learning. So something like WalkMe or WhatFix. And in the end, they did end up going with WhatFix, which is that guided learning that as you go through, it's performance support. So you're not leaving your system. You're not leaving Salesforce while you're on the job. You're not losing time. And in a call center, that's really important because you're not losing time on the phone. You're still on the phone, but it's telling you what to do and what to do next. You're not stopping and going through a 20-minute e-learning, trying to remember it all. And you don't have to take time out away from your desk. It's all just built in and right there. And so that's kind of where we were when I left, was at that point. And at Oracle before that, we were at that same point then, and that was 4 years ago. So they were a little ahead, you could say. We were implementing the Oracle HCM system. And that was, again, we were implementing guided learning throughout that. They had their own guided learning system. But it was the same idea as WhatFix or WalkMe. And that was...
So let's focus on that a little bit, that idea of those platform implementations. Those are really, I mean, they happen all the time, right? I've been a part of SAP implementations and, you know, large, you know, enterprise, you know, implementations like that. You know, what does, when training gets involved in those, it doesn't work, we're not always the most important part of the puzzle, and there's always these issues that go on. And maybe for you in your experience, it's been easier, but in my experience, it's been difficult.
I've been on both sides, and I think at Oracle, I was lucky when we rolled out our HCM system, because it's an HR system, they took all of HR into account. So it was a massive project. It was 2 years. But it was Oracle organizational development team. It was our custom learning team, which was me. It was the HR communications team. And it was the HRIS team who were basically customizing the whole thing. And the Oracle HCM system, it's like Workday or SuccessFactors or anything. It's just the Oracle version. I think it used to be PeopleSoft, and they modified it and made it better. And it's actually a really good system. And we moved to Agile, and we were there from the beginning. And if the HRIS team said we are rolling out the payroll module and these are the parts we're doing, well, training, we were a week behind them. and we worked in the same sprint they did. And we had, everything had small videos and guided learning and a job aid. And the only thing that came out at the exact same time as what they released was the job aid. That was the source of truth.
Yeah, yes, the source of truth. That is a phrase that comes up quite a bit, eh, Chris?
Yeah, I can understand entirely Michelle's perspective on you got to have a starting point, the source of truth, to get something out in sequence with the releases. Gosh, we don't face those kinds of issues here in our own software releases. No, making sure that documentation is at least out there, and I think too, just the way that software changes, etc. That something as simple as a job aid is a great place to start, because you have the least amount of risk, let's say, in terms of changes afterwards. You know, it doesn't take much of an interface change for you to have to remake a video, for instance, all of a sudden, because it's not always easy to just punch in, you know, a screen change in a video, for instance. So sometimes the simplest path is the most effective, but also just the idea of single source of truth, making sure that everything is consistent no matter where you find that information to. Just making sure that people know what they're doing, whether they find that information in, if it's an e-learning course, ahead of using a software tool or something like that, or information that they're finding in the flow of work. Those things all have to match up and be consistent, so that you're not introducing risks or errors or confusions across the organization.
Yeah, and these are some of the business problems that we as L&D professionals solve, right? When we bring to the table as well our knowledge of more than just building a course and understanding, the software that we use, is it capable of creating more than just a course? Can we create all of these different things that support something as large as a massive new software implementation? Not an easy task when you're talking about a very large company across the globe. You're worried about translations. You're worried about, you know, is it, are certain documents going to be small enough to play in countries where maybe the bandwidth is a little bit lower, to devices that don't, you know, that can't handle as much stuff. So you're creating a lot more content when you're needing to support that type of a big rollout. It's a big deal. And our role in that has changed. It's fun to hear her talk about that.
Yeah, something like that. There's such so many separate moving pieces. They don't always move at the same speed either, too. So,
yeah, for sure, for sure. Well, let's jump back to that. We had accidentally gotten cut off. Speaking of bandwidth issues, and so when we jump back into this next part of the interview, Michelle picks back up and recaps a little bit about the project, and then wraps a nice bow on it. But I thought it was important for us to hear the final piece. So let's take a listen to that.
Large project. We worked agile. We worked in sprints with the HRIS team, and we had videos, guided learning, and a job aid, which was the source of truth. We worked a week behind the HRIS team because they always change the UI at the last minute. So the videos would have to, they had to be, we had to wait just a little to do the videos because we knew it was going to change. But the job aid could be the source of truth. That was easy. Grab a couple screenshots, pop it in, roll it out. So that could be out the day there was a release and people could have it. But that way we were always in sync with everybody. And once that was released, comms, HR comms was ready to go. They would have a communication that would go out to not just HR, but everybody, whoever was being entered into that pilot at the time, because we rolled it out. You know, it was an enterprise-wide release that we rolled out slowly across the enterprise. And then of course, OD was very involved because my team worked very closely with them. We reframed the processes. We reframed the talent management processes. We reframed the performance processes because there wasn't a lot of that at Oracle before. And this was our opportunity to say, let's change that and make it matter. Let's give a growth mindset and show why this matters. And so we worked real closely with OD on reframing those things and creating new processes and then creating training to help people develop a growth mindset.
And you know what I love about that, just that quick segment right there, is talking about that growth mindset, which sets us up nicely for our next conversation about the culture shift and the culture change that we are often asked to, you know, support or drive even, right? You know, who owns the culture in your organization? Who owns that responsibility to change that? Because when you can't just change an epic piece of software that controls every or a large portion of the business without having to go through and change all those culture elements too, right?
Yeah, for sure. I mean, you know, the L&D world, we're supposed to be helping people change behaviors to improve things, processes, et cetera, so that the organization can benefit from those changes. And something as large as an enterprise level software tool like that is awful. It's going to, by its very nature, it's going to have to change some processes because tools work differently. Or if there was no tool before, the tool will start to impose new processes on it. So why not take that as an opportunity to extend, you know, a greater level of change to help the organization as well as part of this process?
Absolutely. And it reminds me of another conversation I had recently about how really we're in the change management business, aren't we? I mean, like we're helping people figure out how to deal with change. And it seems like, it doesn't seem like it is, with everything changing so fast these days, we need to be, you know, responsive to that and help folks get along. Let's jump into the next section as we talk with Michelle a little bit more about culture. So this sounds like you guys also impacted a lot of culture stuff too. How important is trying to change that culture to these types of new implementations?
Don't get me started on culture. That's a huge thing for me. I can go on for hours on corporate culture and employee engagement. But
well, maybe we should then.
That particular instance, again, that kind of thing had never been done really at Oracle before, so it was important to really kind of spread the word. And so we created the very last thing I did before I left Oracle is I worked with an international team, and we were creating a learning workshop. It was a learning journey that started with a half-day workshop and then a journey of TED Talks and other things, and then another half-day workshop on how to really take your career into your own hands. Oracle was a very self-serve kind of place. If you wanted to get ahead, you were going to have to figure it out yourself. And so it was how to do that. Here are the things that are available for you. Here are things that are good for you. We even did, I had this wonderful contractor in Chicago. She did this wonderful e-learning course for us that was choose your own adventure. And it was very important to me. And I go, when I'm in interviews now, I go on about this because it's very important to me to bring transparency to the talent process. Nobody knows what goes on. It's like this big secret, nine boxing and all this. Nobody understands it. It's like scary. It's not. And it's there to help you, but nobody knows what it is. So we, with Choose Your Own Adventure, you could be an individual contributor, you could be a manager, you could be an HR person. And you got to see what each person did in this entire process. We went through all of it. What talent reviews are, what nine boxing is, how it all works. So.
What is nine boxing?
Oh, well.
Sorry, give me the Reader's Digest version. Just in case anybody's listening and wants to know too, I figure I'll play the.
There are pros and cons to nine boxing. There are better ways now, I believe, but it is the standard. It's changing. It needs to change. But most companies still use it. Some people even 12 box. But it's where you have high potential, low potential in each corner, and then everybody in between. And you basically just put people in dots all over, identifying your highs and your lows. So you're only going to have 10% of your employees up here in your high lows, right? And then ideally everybody else is kind of in the middle. And then hopefully you're not going to have very many down here in the low potential either.
Well, your standard bell curve, but yeah.
Right. And then, you know, you're looking at it and you say, okay, these are the people we really want to push into hypo, and these are the people we really need to focus on in our succession planning that we want to be our next leaders. And you can see all that in the nine box. But there are better ways using technology now to do this that aren't as, there's a lot of bias that can come out in the nine box that can be eliminated now.
Yeah, so we don't have to go down that road, because I'm not too sure how we can help that.
I can go on for hours on both the pros and cons of that. So.
Well, culture is a big deal, right? And trying to figure out how to change. But the conversation around culture that happens a lot in our industry is, the learning culture. We need to be more of a learning culture. Right. How do you see that playing into your concepts around culture?
You know, I see that in a lot of job applications now, or job descriptions. We are a learning culture. That's who we are. And I'm thinking, are you really?
Everybody wants to be one, but are you really?
Are you really?
So what does that look like? What do you see it looking like?
To me, that means it's more than just offering LinkedIn Learning to your team. It's more than just having Skillsoft out there on your LMS, right? It is really supporting coaching internally. It's supporting external training and things that your teams want to go to. It's there's knowledge sharing. And I think this gets back into knowledge management. There is a lot of knowledge out there that I think about UPS, there were people who've been there 30 years who have just been laid off or voluntarily retired in this last layoff. Where a lot of knowledge just walked out that door.
Yeah.
I don't know if or how they caught that knowledge. And I feel like there's a loss there. And there's a way somehow, I think, for learning to look at some of these companies that have these people who've been there for so long with so much knowledge. We need to figure out a way to capture that, I think, and really be able to share that knowledge. And that is something that could be part of a learning culture. People like that, they could give lunch and learns. I mean, something so simple and basic could even, I mean, that costs nothing. It involves very little technology.
Having the infrastructure in place to do that is one thing from a technology perspective, I suppose, but also just having somebody kick off that this is the culture and that it's okay for you to do that or to offer it up if you are the subject matter expert or whatever that's been there for a long time. But also, I think people feel very protective of their knowledge and their IP, right? And so I think in a lot of organizations, I think there needs to be some sort of I don't know what word I'm looking for, but you know, compensation, right? Additional, an attaboy or something, you know, when you do it.
Has to do it is some sort of recognition, but I also think you have to foster a sense of collaboration and not competition. And in a lot of the larger companies that I've been in, there is a sense of competition and not collaboration. Yeah. And I'm, you know, that I think that kind of kills that kind of culture of learning you want. If everybody's competing all the time, you're not really working on supporting people to grow and develop.
Michelle's note about, you know, the sheer quantity of knowledge that's within an organization and how so much of that leaves the organization when the people who know those things leave the organization as well. I thought that was really fascinating because it reminded me actually of one of our own client teams here. Brent, you spent a couple of weeks ago some webinar time with our client team at iPaper, who've done a really cool job. They keep a fairly small L&D team. And that L&D team really works on empowering other employees to be able to contribute knowledge, information, short learning courses, et cetera. They've trained them all up in using Domino One to author content. And they basically, anybody, I think, you know, within the organization can put their hand up and say, hey, I've got some things I'd like to, you know, put together and share, et cetera. All that expertise, all that, you know, implicit knowledge, particularly that people who are masters of a particular, you know, space know and work from almost on autopilot, but getting that out, giving them that opportunity. I mean, the iPaper team's doing, you know, hundreds of pieces of content, you know, per year, driven by the broader pool of talent and knowledge experts within their organization.
Yeah, it's a perfect solution to what we were talking about earlier about the speed and the rate of change. And one team of L&D professionals, instructional designers, e-learning developers can't possibly do it all on their own. So I think as professionals, we have no choice but to get better at empowering the people that we serve to also get in there and share their knowledge and to create those digital assets that can, you know, that are then part of that sharing process, right? And allowing them to do that. Gosh, there's so much in that last segment in her conversation, you know, even talking about the choose your own adventure, right? It was at the beginning of it. And I don't want that to go to waste, but, you know, just knowing that you can create that kind of, you know, branching simulation in a tool like Domino or, you know, use game development ideas to design some really cool interactions. And then to, you know, kind of wrap it up, put a bow on it, you know, being able to just build very, very, very simple templates that, you know, you don't have to train those subject matter experts to be e-learning developers. It's just, hey, here's a few templates. Go ahead and put your content in there. Heck, if somebody wants to get motivated enough and learn more about the tool and amp that up, that's great. But, you know, you can make it as easy and simplistic or as complex as you want. And it's such a great example, such a great way to tie those two things together for sure.
Yeah.
So yeah, let's jump into the next segment. This is all good stuff. It's got my brain spinning.
Grow and develop.
So therein lies the toughest part of this culture challenge within any company, but I think mostly within large companies where that there is that original sort of old school mindset of competition. And because competition to a certain extent does foster people to work harder and to, you know, move up and whatnot. But I think in this day and age, more of a collaborative culture ends up being more impactful. And I don't know. I haven't read any research on any of that stuff, but it feels like we're headed in that way. At least.
Kinder. You know, it's just kinder. I think some of that, I look at some of the big companies I've been a part of in my career, and I think we get too siloed.
Yeah.
I've never worked in this kind of organization, but I think I would prefer in a large company a center of excellence for learning, where everything is kind of brought in there, and that if you need learning, you need instructional design, you request it through the center of excellence. You get really talented instructional designers who can then help you go through the whole process with you, whether it's Sam, whether it's Addie, they're going through an actual process with you and helping you decide what you need, not what you want. That was a big thing for me at Oracle, was I changed this from being order takers to consultants, because sometimes people didn't need what they thought they wanted. And
yeah, you know, a day-long workshop boondoggle at the resort probably isn't going to solve your problem.
But you need a webinar. Sometimes this isn't going to solve your problem at all. So let's find some other way to do it. And so I think having a center of excellence where people really know what they're doing and can really help you, that's going to help. And I think right now in so many companies that I've worked in, learning at UPS, we had 22 different learning teams. And I think at Oracle, we had more than that. And we never talked to each other. We didn't really share resources. At UPS, we rarely shared resources. And we should have. And it's something I always try to do is reach out, but it's just hard. And I think bringing all that in, when you're siloed, you risk being separated out from the overall goals of the business. When you're a center of excellence, you become much more aligned to the business needs, I think, which is really the ultimate goal, right?
And doesn't everybody become more efficient too? I mean, I know there's always, in my experience, there's always been this shift depending upon the leader, right? There will be dispersed training groups for a little while, and then that leader will get promoted out, and then a new leader comes in and says, we should be centralized, we should be a central organization. So they pull everyone together. And then a few years later, another new leader comes in and says, no, we'd be much more effective if we were dispersed and decentralized.
My learning utopia is centralized.
There's got to be a hybrid, I think, at some point. But it also plays into the role of, being able to share resources. You mentioned that in the collaborative nature of organizations and their people and the work that they do, being able to, function together collaboratively, sharing, digital assets, sharing knowledge.
Software licenses.
There you go.
You look at decentralized locations, you've got everybody trying to get in their own licenses of Articulate, when you probably could have an enterprise license and just fix the problem. So everybody having to go through security and everything else that you have to go through these big organizations, just fix it. Have a centralized organization, get one enterprise license.
Yep. And then have a centralized, digital asset management system, and you're good to go, right? And or a platform that does them all, which would be which is good. Therein is the pitch, right? You could tell where my head was spinning, eh?
Well, so many pieces of the equation. You might have licenses of individual tools, but then things are still spread out all over the place. Whereas, clearly with Domino One, no surprise, everything's in one place, hence the name. But thinking too about Michelle talking about 22 different groups doing training, et cetera. Well, think about how much overlap and time wasted and stuff is spent. 22 different groups all doing fire safety training that includes things, information on how to use a fire extinguisher. Well, how to use a fire extinguisher is pretty universal. Make it once and everybody can share, use that resource. Nobody's remaking it and spending extra time. But then every group could have, their own unique content added to that. Where are the fire extinguishers located in a particular facility, for instance? That's not universal. So that's the localization, piece of the equation. But saving cost and saving time, and then updating things, right? If that pin ever changes in the fire extinguisher, you make that one edit and everybody's got the new content sent out to them. That's the power of not just her model of a centralized department, but of centralized, tools that have everything in one place, being able to empower reusing things, and not just for e-learning, right? I'm not sure that if you needed a fire extinguisher, you'd be able to have the time to actually go and look for a job page. But if but other types of content where it's all centrally managed, and that back to that one source of truth, it's all the same for everybody. Everybody's got the exact same information, and that consistency.
Yeah, I think in that scenario you've put together, it may not be a job aid needed at the moment of need, but it could certainly be a very short micro learning that's delivered out every so often to keep everybody refreshed. Maybe it's just one video that just gets rolled out every few months just to give people a refresher on, hey, if you have to use it, this is how it's done. And you just get it doesn't take any time at all. You can watch it on any device you want, just so many different solutions. But yeah, that whole idea of centralizing the things that you need to get your job done. So if we're looking at what value that brings and what business problems it solves for us as training professionals and for a training manager in the organization, or L&D is a large organization, it's just knowing that you're just going to log into just one system. Everything that you're going to need to build whatever solution that you're looking to build is going to just be there. And you don't have to call three different departments. Who's got this? Who's got that source? Who's got that? Oh, wait, no, that contractor walked out the door with that file. And so we got to recreate it. Nothing like that. Everything just sits in the right spots. It just, yeah, it's one of the things I love the most. So always excited about that one. For sure. So let's jump into the next segment, which is good as well. So, all right. So let's talk a little bit about, before we wrap this up real quick, give me your thoughts on, we mentioned knowledge management a couple of times, but let's just talk to it specifically. In your experience, where does knowledge management as a part of the organization or as part of the work fall into the things you've experienced and the work that you've done? Where do you see it applying?
I hadn't really thought about it till you brought it up, to be honest. And talking with others about it, it's that curation of knowledge. And then from learning, we create behaviors out of that curated knowledge. And
so nobody in so when you were at UPS or whatever, there was no internal knowledge management team?
I realized this morning there actually was. And you know what they did? They did the guided learning. They're the ones who did what fix. They brought forth all that knowledge from the SMEs and they were pulling it together into the guided learning for Salesforce. And that team did other things too, and I don't actually know what.
It's interesting. Yeah, in my research and just in talking to people about this, I've discovered that that knowledge management teams and the concept still exists. It just falls under different names, or it's a responsibility that falls into a different group. So tech writers, those departments that would write technical specs, things like that, they have a tendency to play a massive role in that knowledge management piece. And of course, L&D and training teams connect, or because they need that content, right? But that's, I don't know if things have changed or what.
I still think of it as whoever is dealing with that knowledge, we are the curators of that knowledge, and we decide how that knowledge gets dispersed. And no matter what the team is called, you're the curator. And I think about, we had a giant website at Oracle. I don't know if they still do. It was our intranet, and it was just a mess of information. You had to know where to look to find anything, but everything you could ever need was on that website. But it was just a portal, one page. That needed curation worse than anything I've ever seen. That needed knowledge management. All the knowledge was there. It just needed to be managed. Yeah. And so that's like a very simple, a web portal, a very simple example of knowledge management, but it's an example of curation at its best. A museum is knowledge management. It's curation. So I'm really stuck on that for knowledge management. And I think whoever is doing it, whether it's tech writers or I think it was a very technical team that was doing it at UPS in our call center training, doing the knowledge management, and then or if it's L&D, whoever's doing it, they're the curators and they're sort of the keeper of that information, the gatekeepers of how that information is set free.
Yeah, for sure. And I think that's just that whole gatekeeping, and that I always talk about it as like the access is number one. Like I think for a lot of folks, that portal or the multiple many portals that a lot of organizations have that makes it really confusing. And then you as a learner or a seeker of this knowledge, you go try to find it. You find the thing that you want, or at least it looks like it, and you click on it and it says you don't have access to it. And it's like, what?
You shouldn't have to have training on how to use your portals.
It should be that easy, right? Yes, everything should be that easy. But I wonder, as I'm thinking to myself, Chris, is it possible to build a knowledge base or something like that with an e-learning authoring platform?
Well, let me think now. Wheels turning. Yeah. I'm, let's face it, it's part of what we're able to help empower people do with Domino One. No matter what people, whether you're wearing a KN type hat or more of an L&D type hat, we've always got to give people information, you know, before they actually can do certain tasks, etc. on the job. We've got to get them up to speed. And so that's formal learning. That might be e-learning courses in your LMS, etc. But we all know that even if there were 5 courses in onboarding someone and each course had a quiz, 20 questions, and the learner aced every one of those with 20 out of 20 on the quiz, 2 months later when they actually have to do some of those tasks now back in the job, we know that the memory is not going to be there. It's not going to have sunk into long-term memory because it probably didn't include, well, first of all, there's time, practice, etc. But now you need that info. And you've got to do that job. And that is, of course, where performance support, knowledge-based kind of content applications come in. But there's no reason why those two pieces of content should ever be different. The steps to do a task should be the same, whether you are learning it before you're qualified to do the tasks or in the moment when you actually have to do that task. So again, that one source of truth, putting it all in one place, making sure that it's consistent and up to date. So if that task changes between, oh, you did the training 2 months ago, but now you have to, but there's been a system change or something since then, so the steps are different. Well, now you know that it's up to date and it's right there and everything's consistent no matter where someone is finding it. Really one of the key things that I'm proudest of what we've been able to do with Domino One is to be able to bridge that formal and informal learning aspect of things in our world.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think, in our circles of L&D and training and instructional design, some of this stuff seems pretty, it might sound pretty redundant, but we're hoping to influence and help managers also understand that there are tools available that can do more than just train courses, and that your training team can be empowered to build so much more and add value to the organization more than just being a training department, right? Managing the knowledge base and the content that goes there. All of these areas that we're able to support and add value to, it just keeps growing and growing and growing. And, you know, we're not the same old training teams that we used to be back in the day. So
that curation role that Michelle was talking about, so important, no matter which, no matter what the shingle says above our department section of the cubicle zone. So.
Right. Yeah. Well, let's go to the future of talent management and see what she thinks about that as we get close to wrapping up.
Regarding,
where we go. Well, let's do this. Let's talk about, where do you see the future of talent? Let's just go there. What does it look like besides the AI stuff? We'll wrap up heading back towards in that world, right? Like what would be the ideal sort of, talent or, functional group?
I see a lot of things wrapped into HR and talent. Right now, organizational effectiveness is really important. And I think that alone can pull in wellness, I think is really important, that I think it gets overlooked by a lot of companies. And I think that encompasses everything from, are you going into work? And if you are going into an office, how is the office set up? that falls into wellness as far as I'm concerned. And how often are you going into the office? And how often are you on Teams meetings? And do you get wellness stipends? So many companies now actually give like wellness days or wellness stipends. Go join a gym or go take a day once a quarter and get a massage. I love that. I love when companies think we need to do something because we're stressing our employees out so often. We need to at least make sure they're happy one day a quarter. That needs to be part of HR. Wellness needs to be part of HR, probably in OE. So you've got OE, OD, and a lot of companies don't even have an OE team. And then you've got talent management, which needs to be more than just let's do performance reviews. It needs to be how do we develop our employees and make things better? And how can we look at that holistically and develop our employees individually, but develop our teams? Figure out who our high potentials are, but figure out who the people are who want to be the high potentials. I think they get overlooked a lot. And I think there are a lot of people out there with the potential to be high potentials. And then, you know, then there's just the rest of us. How do we keep our employees happy? And a lot of that really may fall to learning and development.
Yeah.
We need to offer training that doesn't interrupt, I think. You can only do so much with compliance, but we've got the access now to tools that will let us create some really great training that doesn't necessarily interrupt our day-to-day workflow, that doesn't bore us to tears. We no longer have to click the next button. There's just a lot of stuff we can do that integrates into the flow of work. I'm a huge proponent of performance support. And I think that can just be pulled into what we're doing on so much stuff. I think the technology's there for us now. It's caught up to what we need. We've always needed it, but now the technology's there for us. That's my HR department. Oh, plus like the benefits and total rewards people. But that's my HR department.
I love it. I love it. And that is a great, great place, I think, for us to wrap up our conversation. That pretty much wraps it all up in a nutshell. Thank you so much, Michelle, for hanging out with me today.
Thanks for chatting with me.
What's your perfect HR org, Chris?
Well, I've never worked in an HR department, so I think I'm not qualified to offer something on that. But, you know, some reflections, right? People, retention of employees, the folks who do have the knowledge, keeping those folks. There's so much that culture and sense of value, et cetera, that plays in making sure that you can retain employees, because that's, and, you know, the cynical perspective is that it costs so much more to hire someone than it does to, you know, to retain them and not have to look for a replacement for, you know, for example, on that front. Wellness stipend. Let's go get a massage maybe, eh? Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Speaking of that, that's what that alarm was. I think mine starts in 20 minutes now.
Oh, well, happy wellness stipend then. Right?
So. Oh, that's perfect. Yeah. You know, happiness and keeping everybody happy is an exceptionally interesting concept, right? Who owns that? Does somebody need to be responsible for being happy? Maybe that's a conversation for another time. And I do happen to know just the person to talk to about that, but I'll save that as a teaser for another conversation as we wrap up today. Chris, this was a fun one.
Yeah, this was a really great conversation, Brent. And thanks so much for bringing it to us. Really cool to hear from Michelle, especially with that background at Oracle and UPS, those really big organizations, which it's funny, the big organizations, sometimes the phrasing is big ships turn slow, but sometimes they're actually, you know, real hotbeds of innovation too, just because of the different contexts that they can draw on, et cetera. So really, really great to have that. So thanks for bringing that to us, Brent. And of course, thanks to everyone who joined us here live today. If you haven't already, be sure to sign up for innovation updates on the Domino website. That's at www.domino.com/innovation with, of course, our funky spelling of innovation. We can't spell things straight up around this place. We're all about the wordplay at times. So, folks, thanks so much for joining us. We look forward to seeing you in our next session. Brent, looking forward as well to, who you're bringing it to us in the next session as well.
As usual, we will have a super fun conversation, and I'm not even going to tease it, because if it changes, then this recording will be wrong. So everybody sign up and you'll get the notification when we know it for sure. So anyways, thanks, Chris. Always good to chat with you on these, and we'll see you all in the chat room next time. I'm gonna go get some more.